that the ISO 9001 standard, ISO 14001, is built upon the notion of high-level structure, HLS. If you don't remember what it is, I would be happy to remind you briefly. High-level structure is the standardization of the structure of all standards for management systems. Here, the same basic content, terminology, and definitions are used in all standards of management systems. The main requirements for individual systems will be the same. However, they will differ in how detailed they are and what specific requirements they include with regard to a given management system. Thanks to this structure, it is now easier to read and interpret the requirements of standards. And as a result, the integration of systems has become much easier. Now, let's move on to the basic definitions of an environmental management system. The environmental management system involves a number of definitions, the understanding of which is necessary to properly interpret and meet the requirements of the standard. Let's start by discussing what the term environment means. The environment is the surroundings in which the organization operates: the air, water, land, natural resources, flora, fauna, people, and their interrelationships. The environmental management system is based on the notion of dealing with the so-called environmental aspects. As environmental aspect is an element of an organization's activities, products, or services that interacts with or may interact with the environment. So it may affect the environment. What is an environmental impact? This is a change in the environment, both adverse and beneficial, which as a whole or partly results from the environmental performance of the organization. Examples? I will give you some of them. Let's imagine that you are the president of the management board of the transportation company. You have a huge fleet of cars and your trucks drive hundreds of thousands of kilometers per month. The process to be analyzed will be transport. The environmental aspect, emission of greenhouse gases. The impact on the environment, air quality deterioration. Another environmental aspect may be the use of liquid fuels, and the associated impact will be the use of limited natural resources. I hope you now understand what the environmental impact is. Now it's time for an exercise. Look at the table on the slide. Turn on the pause and try to complete the table. You can get started now. Are you ready? Great! Now let's move on to the requirements of the standard. We will start with the context of the organization. Defining the context of the organization should be the first step in describing the risk management model within the company. This is also the first step in implementing the management system, including the environmental management system. If it is a risk-based system, we can establish and enact a system that will be effective, efficient, and adapted to the company's needs. The standard requires an organization to define the internal and external factors that may affect the implementation of its strategy and objectives in relation to its environmental management system. It is important to define those internal and external factors that are related to the organization's environmental performance and that may affect the organization's main objective. Changes in the availability of resources, changes in the environment, changing legal requirements, and changing social expectations may be crucial in conducting successful business activities, as they are factors of both risk and opportunity. Examples of such factors are spatial management plans, location of the company, the center of the urban agglomeration, limitations in air emissions, for example, due to the company's location, customers' pressure to use returnable packaging, the employees' environmental awareness. Let's imagine a situation in which we run a company located in the center of an urban agglomeration. While examining the context of the organization, we need to consider possible limitations resulting from its location. Restrictions on air emissions, industrial water discharges, noise, relations with residents. I'm sure you've heard of at least one company whose environment policies have met with local resident protest, for instance, due to the odor emission related to the organization's activity. You might also have heard about companies that have had to move their operations to the other end of the world due to the impossibility of their development as a result of restrictions on air emissions, for example. Of course, these are elements of the context of the organization that companies identify as threats and therefore take preventative measures against. Having analyzed the organization's internal and external environment, we can focus on the needs and expectations of the so-called stakeholders. With regard to the requirements of the standard, the organization should define the stakeholders that are relevant to the environmental management system and specify their requirements. For instance, stakeholders are customers, social groups, for example, neighbors, suppliers, contractors, including subcontractors and service providers, authorities, NGOs, the Sanitary Epidemiological Service and Technical Inspection Office, investors or employees. The subsequent step is to identify the stakeholders' requirements with regard to the environmental management system and to determine which of these requirements automatically constitutes a compliance obligation. Is it not clear? I will explain. Let's assume that one of the stakeholders is the local town hall that requires the relevant environmental charges to be paid and within a specified time limit. This is an example of a compliance obligation. The amount of environmental charges, as well as their type and time limit, are regulated by the legal requirements applicable in a given region, province, and country. The production company is always obliged to meet this requirement. Once we have the context of the organization defined and we know the stakeholders and their requirements, we can consider the scope of the environmental management system. While defining a quality management system, we take into account all internal and external factors identified in the course of analyzing the context of the organization. Moreover, we consider the requirements of stakeholders, including compliance obligations, our organizational unit needs and functions, all in relation to the products and services of the organization. Remember that when the organization is, for instance, entitled to transport or dispose of waste, or has a water treatment plant, these powers and functions should be included in the environmental management system.